Hello. Oh, that's much better.
Yeah.
Woo! Yeah, and I actually have very strong views on ICOs and what is considered a good and bad project, which I will share with you. And part of that comes from having run a successful ICO, arguably the most successful ICO of October and November. So looking forward to talking about that.
So I think to kick it off, I'm going to actually ask James, because James has been working with startups a long time, not necessarily cryptocurrency startups, but evaluating all different kinds of startups. One question I think that's been running around is the ICO white paper just a complete waste of space, waste of time? Should we evaluate ICOs more as we look at traditional startups rather than seeing them as a separate kind of special phenomenon?
I'll start talking this way. Oh, there's the mic, it's working. Look, it's a really great question because I get this question every day. I see an ICO on my Facebook feed, and should I invest in it? Is it of value? Now, back at our Series A, which we raised, which was traditional VC investors, I'd like to think that the money that we got at the end of the round is pretty much what a successful ICO is at the end. But you do need to spend a fair bit of time, 3-4 months, doing, white paper's pretty much like a pitch deck. You want to put more details in it. The one thing that is very clear what's a good and a bad ICO is the level of English in a lot of them. And so one thing in the VC world will be if you need to get a third party to help you raise funds. That is a consistent and obvious sign that your team hasn't got the caliber to build a strong company. So I would be looking at ICOs and startup fundraising in exactly the same way. One thing I'm excited about, though, in this space is that the ICO space and the way we look at it is only going to get better, because we were talking last night about, how many new ICOs are on the market today. Now, to put it in perspective, maybe there's 50, 60 a day, maybe 100 being launched every day. If you put it into traditional VCs, there's about 500,000 companies around the world trying to raise money today. So there is so much upside in the ICO space. The one thing, though, we're seeing, though, from a startup versus ICO space is that VCs can get a liquid return faster. And I think that's where a lot of the VCs need to evolve and die. So even though the same fundamentals of a startup fundraise and an ICO should be the same, the liquidity for investors is probably what's more exciting.
Yeah, I mean, I'll come to Abasa now, because one of the issues in the space is that there are so many different token sales, different ICOs going on, and it's great that James is providing data because that's lacking, but also how do we kind of keep all the data in one place? And Abasa was showing me his very cool app last night that he's made. I think it's not live yet, but maybe allowing us to assess some of the fundamentals of an ICO and see all the different ICOs in one place. So can you tell us a bit about what you're doing?
Sure.
And what kind of metrics you use for how to evaluate an ICO?
Right. So my platform, Zilla, it's an ICO sort of marketplace app where you can learn about various aspects of an ICO. And it's built around a framework that I use to personally evaluate ICOs when I'm participating in an ICO. So I call it the 4 T's, and it's about the timeline of the project, the team, the token, and the technology. So the timeline, for me, basically, if a project has a workable beta, or so not just a mock-up, not just a white paper, but something I can see actually moving, that just right off the bat, that will interest me a bit more into the project. So that's the timeline. And then I look at the team. So I look if they're trying to build the next generation blockchain, do they have relevant engineers that can execute on that vision? So I look at each member of the team to see if there's any entrepreneurs on the team, because it's quite difficult running a company your first time around. So if there's seasoned entrepreneurs on your team, that's a plus. I also take a look to see that team members have worked together in the past. It's very important to me because most companies blow up because there's co-founder issues or internal fighting. Then you look at the technology. You see whether or not what they're building, there's a place in the world for it. Is it faster Is it cheaper? Is it easier to use than what currently exists out there? And then I take a look at the token. What's the token used for? You know, how much are they creating? What's the price of the token? And that sort of thing. And I use that as sort of the basic building blocks of what I look for when I participate in an ICO. So I'm based in Japan, and you know, Japanese typically they like quirkier projects. There was a few months ago there was a bar that raised money. They raised like $200,000 through an ICO, and you know, Japan sort of likes that sort of thing. So I noticed that with VC funding it's very regionalized, but with an ICO it has the power to, you know, you can raise money worldwide. And I think with that being said, you'll see different regions have sort of different projects that you know, the community is interested in, and I find that quite interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I think the way it's shaping the landscape for investment is really interesting, and I actually wanted to ask Ken about that, so you've led me nicely into the next question, which is, I mean, you've been an advisor to various token projects. What do the token projects themselves look for in advice? What are they lacking, and what kind of expertise do they need that help them do what they want to do?
What I've seen in my experience is that many projects may have the technical competency to come up with a prototype or product and really discuss the token mechanics in a way that is sensible, but what they can't do is sell that to the world. So community building and engagement, reaching out to different networks and getting the buy-in from, you know, marketers, from developers, from investors, knowing how to put everything together that's in the white paper and put together a story that could excite the public and help them stand out from, you know, the many ICOs that are coming out on a daily and weekly basis. So I've seen a lot of that in my experience. They're also looking for help with raising funds. You know, they may not understand the kind of token economics that would appeal to, you know, an ordinary investor, somebody who's looking at this in terms of, you know, what's the best ROI they can get out of this ICO. So what I've really come up with in helping them understand this is similar to Abbas's 4T's model, but, you know, how many tokens do you plan to have in the supply? What percentage will you make that available to the public in the event that any of those tokens are unsold, or what are you going to do with them? Are you going to burn them, which then transfers value to the investors who bought tokens? And also, how much are you looking to raise? So we're seeing now with really good projects that they're actually listening to this feedback, and even during the course of a token sale, they'll reduce a hard cap, you know, even by as much as 50%, we've seen. And that's very appealing to investors, because there's a concept in the tokenomics where network values, the amount of value that's out there, how much of that is going to be captured by the project? And in the event where we had seen projects that had no product, just a white paper, and raising gobs of money, that leaves the investors with little network value to actually speculate with. And that's the kind of thing you want to avoid. We've seen some pretty high-profile ICOs that have had that kind of model. So it's nice now that we're seeing a sort of, you know, coming back to these lower valuations that are more in line with what should be the value of the protocol. I mean, there's no way of knowing in this speculative phase, but we're kind of moving in that direction.
Thanks. I'm going to come back to the token economics, because I think there's more questions on that about how the coins are allocated and the lockup and so on. But just wanted to ask Richard, I mean, you've actually run your own ICO, and also you're helping other people. In a sense, you're protecting them by auditing the security of these smart contracts. So what's it like to be involved in ICO? What did you learn from doing it? And on the security side, I mean, obviously a lot of these projects are based on smart contracts. So what are the things that people should maybe be worried about or suspicious of in terms of the security of their investment or their purchase of a token?
So I want to kind of give some value to the audience. So during the running of the token sale, I think actually there's kind of three points that are pretty important when considering an ICO to invest. Number one is like skin in the game, because you know, like leading up to the token sale, me and my co-founder, Steven, we actually spent a long time, like 5 months before, working on a white paper, finding the right advisors who are actually going to kind of be in our corner the whole way and help us the whole way, and also finding the right employees. So like before we really started, we already had 4 PhDs who were assigned on to work with us, and they had like combined citations of like 500 citations. I think this like groundwork is actually very easy to look at when you do due diligence on these projects to see how long have they actually worked on this before embarking on the token sale, and like what was their previous businesses. So, and then number two, I think I see a lot of projects right now that are bringing existing world businesses onto the blockchain. And I think that's too early. Right now, it's kind of like the internet in 1994. And there's still security issues and also scalability issues that in Ethereum that everyone's addressing. So it's kind of too early to be bringing on like Uber for the blockchain. So I think good projects right now are more protocol level projects that are going to improve the adoption. And then I think number three is the token economics and the distribution of the tokens. What I'm seeing is that some projects, the distribution is like less than 50% of the tokens are going to the public. If you consider how like a decentralized network and like a trustless network works, is that the public should be controlling a majority of the tokens, in my opinion. So like these projects that have a third of the tokens going to the public, it's not really governed by, you know, like a in a decentralized fashion, and that kind of goes against the principles that, you know, this was built on, starting with Bitcoin, Ethereum. So I think even just looking at the white paper, looking at the depth of level of thinking that went into like trying to make this a trustless protocol or trustless business, and then looking at their like hard cap and token distribution percentages, actually helps a lot to filter out projects, because once you go through those three steps, you actually end up with a very small universe of projects. And I'm kind of actively doing this because we're doing security auditing for projects, and I'm seeing about 2 projects a day that approach us to get audited, and we're constantly doing due diligence on this front. And after going through those steps, there's actually very few projects that come out of that, and those generally will be quite successful. So.
I think Abasa had a follow-up on that.
Yeah, so in our app, like we list ICOs, and I get approached by projects all the time, and he's absolutely right. There's a lack of understanding of what goes into a token sale. We're in the midst of our token sale as we speak, and I think, you know, that the legwork that goes into it, the months and months beforehand in preparing for your token sale is. Sort of the general public doesn't really see that, and new ICOs don't see that as well. I get approached all the time for projects to list on our app, and you know, when I look at the token economics, they're planning on raising, you know, $100 million. They launched their ICO 3 weeks ago. There's 4 guys on the team. There's no marketing. There's no community. So there's just a strong lack of understanding for how to actually do it, and there needs to be a bit more information. I think, quite frankly, we need to do a better job of educating startups, not just users, on how to evaluate ICOs, but startups on how to actually conduct a successful ICO.
Yeah, I have a small follow-up on that. Like, it's actually very difficult to do an ICO. You actually need a large staff of supporting people, and the public doesn't really realize this, because, you know, having gone through it, we had, you know, 20 volunteer admins in our community. We had people managing marketing, all this. So it's actually quite difficult.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I was reading a piece the other day saying, you know, that perhaps the best investments in tokens are the ones that are securing some kind of infrastructure for the whole ICO process. And until we have that kind of data and the security and all these other parts of the marketplace in place, that maybe some of these other ICOs should be waiting until that's there before they then launch their tokens. I wanted to come back to the whole issue of kind of regulation of ICOs, because obviously we're in this kind of strange hybrid world where we don't really know what's going to happen. And, you know, there's been some attempts to define that there's sort of a security type of token, but then maybe there's another type of token that's more like an app coin or a utility token. How do you sort of try to define what falls in within those two different camps, if it's possible?
I'd like to start on this one because I'm seeing it from a company now at Series B, where we are looking at tech companies in the blockchain space and how we can acquire them. And from the different types of tokens, the biggest one, which is the biggest hurdle, is of course security. So, you know, one question was asked by a blockchain company to us was, would you acquire us? And we said, yes, but we're not going to buy your tokens. And there's no legal reason for us to. And so one of the things that I see as, at the moment, regulation around the world is still so new and people can't sort of grasp it, particularly central governments, is when people lose the money that they think they've made from a token sale. So a lot of the utility tokens where you're getting, you know, vouchers, access to the platform, what have you, are not necessarily assets that own the IP. So any big company that buys you is going to buy the company and the IP. And honestly, if I was in the situation, why should I care about the tokens? Because they're worth little value for me. So in the ICOs, particularly what we're seeing from a lot of institutional clients is how the regulations stand on people who have store credit. Now, companies can do a lot of things in order to, you know, wipe the value of those tokens out the window, but there needs to be more regulation around the securities framework. I did hear that Austria is sort of leading the pack in this. There's a couple of sort of emerging countries that are looking at Gibraltar, particularly in the online gaming space and esports, but a lot of the traditional countries such as the US, Australia, UK are still going to probably be 3 or 4 years behind the curve before they're ready to sort of accept regulations. But at this point in time, there needs to be done. But I go back to Abbas's point, it's all about education. So as long as companies, ICO companies, are, you know, building, like spending 5 months building a great company, then there's going to be less concern from the general public on, you know, what have I bought and, you know, what ownership do I have in this company? Should there be a sale or should something happen?
Yeah, I mean, I guess for people that are new to the space, there may be people who want to get into this because they can see it's an interesting opportunity, but is there advice for people to know what to do? Let's say they go and buy some tokens from a token sale. What should they do with it? Should they hold on to it? Should they trade it out into another cryptocurrency? Or should they, you know, how do they know what to do with a token once they've got one or more?
Well, that's a good question. It's really important that people think about liquidity options after an ICO. So once you actually receive your tokens from the project, your next, you know, big goal is that there's prominent exchanges that have enough volume to give you the liquidity you need to see a return in the event that you liquidate those tokens. But at any rate, it makes sense to store your tokens safely in a hard wallet. That's what I personally do. But I think, going back to the point about regulation, I think that's something this space badly needs right now. We still haven't really seen best practice emerge and had the kind of failures that we're going to need to have to develop the lessons learned to know how to kind of move this space in a proper direction. And there's a lot of people that are going to get burned. I think 2018 is going to be a very interesting year. And the problem is, even with exchanges now starting to adapt to regulation that hasn't come out explicitly, but has kind of made some suggestions, like the SEC report on the DAO, which established that token is a security token. And, you know, that was the infamous hack that led to the forking of Ethereum. But even that alone, just a report of an opinion with no enforcement action taken, has already seen exchanges now taking due diligence efforts to make sure that they're not listing any tokens that could be deemed as a security. Not just then, but later on, because the SEC has retroactive enforcement capabilities and long-arm jurisdiction. So all it takes is one American purchasing a token to, you know, have a business potentially shut down. So I think even with this lack of exchange support, a lot of people that are taking part in ICOs still don't think far enough to think, what do they do after they get their tokens? Are they going to be listed on exchanges? So you could have a situation where a lot of people have these tokens. They can never reasonably liquidate them because no exchanges are going to list them, or no prominent exchanges will. And I think even with these failures, you know, having the result of a lot of people getting harmed, I think it's we need to put an end to this. So I think it's better to happen sooner than later.
But it's been quite light touch, really, up till now. I'm actually surprised, having come from the world of public policy before I got into cryptocurrencies, that regulation hasn't been sort of brought in more quickly, or they haven't kind of stamped down on certain things harder, given the amount of money going in and the sort of potential risk.
Just to follow up a bit to what Hem was speaking to, you know, I participate in multiple ICOs up until now, and you know, there's two sort of ways to think about it. Like, and I when I speak about participating in ICOs, I don't really think of it so much of as an investment, and I don't actually say that I invest in ICOs. I participate. For me, it's more on the crowdfunding side. So there's kind of a continuum, right? There's investing, and then there's crowdfunding, and I'm a little bit slightly more towards leaning towards crowdfunding personally. So if there's a project that I feel will help grow the cryptocurrency community, or I feel that, you know, the world needs, then I'm more inclined to participate, and I don't so much think about, you know, which exchanges are going to be listed on. However, obviously, if you're in this world for the 1000x or the 500x or the 100x, that's possible, then I think there's nothing wrong with that, and your frame of mind has to be a little bit different. Yeah, and regulatory-wise, actually, you know, I'm in Japan, and Japan came out with a, you know, a licensing framework for the exchanges, and I saw what went into that, and that was, you know, 4 years of really strong lobbying by the top two exchanges in Japan, and, you know, the amount of work that went into that was just, I mean, meetings after meetings, 4 years. So when I look to the U.S., I'm American, so, you know, it's my hope that the U.S. kind of opens up and takes a leadership role in this space, but they just haven't, and it doesn't really look like they're going to be able to be the Silicon Valley of the crypto world going forward. I just don't see it.
I think it was interesting. There was a piece by Laura Shin in Forbes the other day talking about an SEC kind of statement that was made, and it got to the point of asking about decentralized exchanges, and the person speaking just sort of looked quite flabbergasted and shocked, like we hadn't even considered this possibility of what we're going to do about decentralized exchanges, you know, because they may not be under any one jurisdiction. So there's a lot of different aspects to where the regulation focuses on, not just, you know, the how we quantify a token, whether we call it a security, but also, you know, how we decide on the legal jurisdiction of something that's decentralized. Maybe we can't even do that as regulators. I don't think they know the answer to that. I worked with a lot of policymakers, and generally they don't know the answer to that many things. So the industry has to educate those people on what's going on and give them the tools to make those decisions in a better way. I think we have about 10 minutes for questions. I'm going to put my glasses on so I can see who's got their hand up. I'm sure we're going to have tons of questions for the panel. So if you let us know if you have a specific question for a specific person or just a general question for the panel, that would be great. I'll see if I can see anybody. I think we have a lady there with her hand up. Just waiting for the mic. Go. If you can also just stand up maybe and say where you're from, that would be great so we can see you.
Hi, I'm Diana from Australia. Just a question about, so Ethereum, the ICO boom started 2013-14. With NEO, we've seen that since the very first ICO, KYC policies have been put in place. And so what do you think are the implications of that will be in terms of, say, the success of the platform? Adopted by the masses and also security-wise?
Yeah. You know, we've watched, you know, I guess around June, July, there weren't that many projects that were doing KYC on participants, but now the bulk of them do. And, you know, they're getting in front of regulations. And you can see going forward, like, our company is based in Singapore, which requires it. Japan will require it. China shut ICOs down. But if they ever open it up again, I'm 100% sure that they will require it. So going forward, I'm pretty sure that most jurisdictions will require KYC. So it's about, you know, as an ICO, how do you prepare for that and get in front of the regulations?
Yeah, I mean, I think getting ahead of the regulations is key. It also provides comfort to policymakers that the industry wants to do things in the right way.
Yeah, I have something to add. I think, like, there's a fundamental reason why projects should have KYC. And it's to future-proof the project. Like, if you imagine these things are going to get delivered in anywhere between 6 months to 3 years, in that time, there could be a reason to return funds to the original investors, and you need to know their identities to do that. So it's pretty important, actually, to have KYC processes.
Yeah. I think we have a question from a chap here in the middle who's had his hand up for a while.
Eugene from South Africa. Thank you, panel. Very interesting discussion. Richard, you mentioned earlier that the type of projects that will now be worthwhile are the ones that will assist with stronger protocols to ensure wider adoption. This might be a cheeky question, but any particular current ICOs or projects which the panel are interested in?
I've been looking at a couple. These sidechain projects are very interesting. Like, I actually invested in Raiden. It's a pretty great project. And right now I'm looking at one called Go Network. It's also a sidechain project for like mobile. So we're looking at that one, and we're also thinking of auditing that one. What about you guys?
I should just say this doesn't constitute official investment.
This does not constitute investment advice.
Well noted.
For all of the speakers, I'll just say that as a general disclaimer.
I've made a sabbatical in December not to do any ICOs. I always think that, particularly leading up to Chinese New Year, there will be not the great returns that I see, but one thing that I'm heavily involved is the currency hedge. I also think, and you probably need to quote me on this one, that we'll probably see 20,000 on Bitcoin by Chinese New Year when everyone gets their bonus. So I know I've just done a soundbite there. Sorry, CNBC. I'm looking at currencies at least until March.
Disclaimer, this is not financial advice. Just wanted to put that out there. I recently invested in Zilliqa, which is high-speed blockchain that's meant to bring scalability solution to the Ethereum network, because Ethereum in current state just really isn't scalable for, you know, the kind of everyday applications we would want out of it. They did a pretty big reduction in their hard cap leading into the ICO, and the lockup. They had shortened the lockup to a much shorter period of time. So there was a lot of demand, and what I found in my experience is when there's scarcity around an ICO, and the idea is one that many people think is a valid use case, it tends to do well in the short term. But like I said, not financial advice.
I like our project, ZLA.io. Take a look.
It's really great, apparently, available in all good exchanges.
There's a few projects coming up that I'm interested in as well. I'll mention them on our social channels at some point, but I'll leave it for then. But I would say Bitcoin 2018, by this time next year, we'll probably see it at $100,000. That's where I think it's at.
Otto.
I'm going to try and take two more questions in a group if I can. So there's someone here at the front. And then if we have someone from this side of the room, just to not leave out this side of the room. I don't see any hands up over there. Anyone? Someone at the back there, right at the back.
Hi guys, my name is Bas Offers from px.com and Rev Media. I'm based in New York. I have a question about the thoughts of the panel on current and active profitable businesses doing an ICO instead of doing a Series B or Series C funding, and what your expectations are for 2018. And in addition, what are your thoughts on the tokenomics of a company doing so? So thinking about actually offering those tokens for a discounted price, what is the impact on the model of the company that's actually profitable today?
Okay, great question. I'm just going to take one from the back as well, so we have two together because we only have a few minutes left. I mean, I think that's a really interesting question. I've had some companies coming to me to talk about doing ICOs that are not in any way in the cryptocurrency space. It's an interesting question whether you can bring those currencies sort of into that world.
Do you want me to answer that first while you get the next question?
Just waiting on a question from the back. Do you have the mic?
Okay, yeah. Thanks, James, for mentioning Austria. I'm Paul from Hero. We did the first ICO in Austria and I think also one of the first legal in the European Union. And I know Austria is really pushing the regulations. They want to have more ICOs in Austria. And which other countries do you see, like, they also want to be an ICO country? And if you would start now an ICO, which country would you go for?
Okay, great. So is there a kind of competitive marketplace for ICOs around the world? I think if everyone can maybe give just a quick comment. We only have a couple of minutes left, so I'd love to hear views on both.
I'll quickly answer your question. Every single one of my investors is asking, do your Series B and C as an ICO? Because they want liquidity, even though we're about a $100 million company by traditional VC funds, everyone wants to do that. Because investors want to hit their funds, they want to get their money back for their funds. There is probably in 2018 much better companies, particularly the Silicon Valley crowd coming in, where they'll have good Series B, Series C companies doing an ICO. And that will actually not be led so much by the startup, but by the funds who have invested in the startup. So watch this space, but I can say from personal experience, we get asked this almost every second day from our existing investors to do one. The second question, and I'll pass it to everyone else. Austria, yes. Gibraltar, yes, as I mentioned. I do see a couple of countries putting their heads in, but I can tell you where not to do it. Probably China, Hong Kong, USA, UK, Australia. I think Singapore may take a lead on this one. I'm also very, very interested in what India's doing in this space. Watch that space in India. That could be the game changer.
I'll answer the enterprise blockchain one because I'm seeing a lot of these projects coming in 2018. They're approaching us now. It's going to be gigantic. And actually, I'm of the opinion that some of them are extremely good because with blockchain, it actually has the ability to change incentives in existing businesses by adding this like payment system, and some of them actually work. So that's my opinion. Yeah.
So for the first question, many VCs have startups in their portfolio that are just struggling or on the brink of failure, and actually encouraging any startup that can potentially have a token model for its business to ICO. So, think of it as a rephrasing of Murphy's Law. Any startup that can ICO will ICO. And what we see too is that, there's a lot of demand for short-term liquidity. So that's one of the disruptions of the token model. And these equity investors that, would ordinarily need to wait 7 or 8 years to potentially see liquidity event, in the form of an acquisition or IPO, now can get that in a very short period of time. So that's just a very compelling, scenario. For the second question, I've been to a couple of jurisdictions that are really just making themselves crypto-friendly, Gibraltar being one, and Zug, Switzerland. And I was really impressed by Zug just because of the public-private partnership. They have a Crypto Valley Association and just a favorable regulatory climate, a lot of buy-in from the politicians in Manhattan to make themselves, a center of the world for the cryptocurrency space.
You can both ICO and go skiing at the same time.
So I'll be brief. Let's see. On Zilla, we have, I'm absolutely inundated with existing companies who are preparing their ICO right now. It's incredible. Traditional VC is dead as we know it. It's already gone. It's dead. And number two, as a jurisdiction, I would say either Japan or Gibraltar. Gibraltar is looking very nice. So, yeah, that's it. To the moon, folks, to the moon.
Thank you. Thanks so much to all the panel.
Thank you.
So I have to stay here for the next panel, so you'll be seeing a bit more of me. Next panel coming up is Protocols of the Future, which I think is going to be a fascinating panel. So looking forward to hearing from all our panel, just making their way onto the stage now. Okay, welcome everybody. This panel is really about next generation protocols. We touched on this earlier on about the problems of existing blockchains and how new protocols are coming on board. I'm delighted to welcome all the panel. We have some excellent technical experts here and people, again, that have been involved in the cryptocurrency space a long time. So on my left, we have Maxim Posnikov, who's the chief evangelist at Universa. Then we have Mance Harmon, who's the co-founder and CEO of Swirls and Hashgraph. We have next Crystal Rose, who joined us just very recently. So delighted to have Crystal here. I think she's just finished her own token sale. So she's been a busy lady traveling to lots of different countries. And we also have Preeti Kesareddy here, who's a blockchain engineer. And she previously worked at Coinbase, and she's now the lead blockchain engineer of Mercury Protocol. So welcome, everybody. Nice to meet you. I met nearly everybody yesterday. I didn't manage to meet Preeti, so really hope I've pronounced your name correctly. And very nice to meet you. I think we're going to run this panel slightly differently because there's so much new information about these protocols and most people don't really know that much about them yet or how they work. So we're going to kind of follow the panel down, I hope, and get each person to talk a little bit about their new protocol and just explain why they see a need for a new protocol, what's wrong with the existing systems that they're trying to fix. So I think as we organized it, that Max was going to kick off for us.
Yeah. Thank you for letting me be the first one to speak. Is it okay? Do you hear me? Okay, thank you. So I want to talk about the future, but before we start talking about the future, we have to look back into the past. And let's start with the past of technology. In 1885, Carl Benz introduced the whole new technology. It was first world serial automobile. It was called patent Autowagen or something like that. It was legendary. Its impact on the whole world was great, but no one drives it now because, let's admit it, it is slow, it is uncomfortable, it even didn't have the steering wheel, some arm for that. So now we drive modern cars. Let's look at current so-called classical blockchains, like Bitcoin or Ethereum. We should never underestimate their impact in the world we are living currently. But let's admit the obvious. They are slow, they are too expensive, and they are not really smart. And that's why we built Universa, a new generation blockchain protocol. I will not go deep into technical details, I just don't have time for that, but just some points. First, our speed. We can handle at this point 25,000 transactions per second. If you compare that to Ethereum, it has below 20. Bitcoin has below 10, you know it. Why do we have such speed? Because we don't store everything in one single blockchain for all. Instead, we have cloud computation, and we allow anybody to have its own private, secure blockchain in the cloud. Universa stores final states of contracts, verifies it. If you want to know more, you can always find me after the panel. We don't rely on a community of untrusted actors, so any random person cannot run a node. That's why, then it comes to critical questions of privacy for enterprises or for governments. Governments can always rely that our distributed network is run by certified nodes. It is still decentralized, it is still distributed, but we have some kind of moderation opportunities. Then smart contracts. Okay, Ethereum smart contracts is what we have now. But let's admit, they are not really smart, and they actually are not contracts. In Universa, we have real smart contracts. First of all, it's contract. So if you show it to the lawyer, it can he can read it. He can actually understand what is it all about. It's not some solidity strings only. And our contracts are smart because they can be written in several languages like JavaScript, CoffeeScript, or even Scala. So basically, our smart contract can be a full-scale application. It can even have a graphical user interface, which is very important. Of course, we thought about money. You can, through Universa, you can tokenize any asset, and you can tokenize money. You can tokenize Bitcoin, you can tokenize any cryptocurrency, you can tokenize even fiat money and make smart contracts with them. Our smart contracts can look not only inside the network, they can take information from the outside world. They can take information from your bank account if you allow that. And we are cheap. You know, Ethereum was planned to be cheap, right? But then the token price went up and it is ruined. We foresee that. That's why our transaction price is stable and it is 1 cent. For you can have 100 transactions for dollar. And this stays the same. You still pay for transactions in tokens, but if token were